Are you playing a game or what are you doing there?
No, I'm building a keylogger.
Everywhere, most of the time we're unaware, but horses know we're leaking all the time. When looking in the fridge, when coughing does the bidding bridge, your sardinals for fun and for the prize, cause sardinals are with us all the time.
Ah, so in this episode, we will finally explain cache template attacks, right?
Yeah, and this was pretty much how we developed the idea of cache template attacks in the first place. As I said in the beginning, it's not just about knowledge, but a mindset. And so we need to show the context in which these ideas come up.
So what are you doing?
There are tons of shared libraries, and some of them are related to user interfaces. And
you want to attack them?
Yes.
A cache attack?
Exactly. So I thought with flush and reload, because they are shared libraries, right? So they are shared anyway.
Did you check the source code?
Yeah, wait, let me show you. So I have the source code opened here. So there are two interesting parts in there. First, this key uni-c file in the GDK library. And here's this variable GDK keysim to Unicode. And the other is this GDK key names where they do a binary search, B search.
This sounds like what you should attack.
Yeah, but there's one problem. So look at this variable here, this GDK keysim to Unicode tab.
Mm-hmm.
It's not in binary. I'm not even sure whether it's used in the version that I compile.
Okay, so what are you trying instead?
I have been also taking a look at object dump, so with the assembly there, but it's really difficult to find anything in there, and I also can't find it in there, so it's...
Maybe we can have a look at together and see whether we can automate this task.
Yes. Right now, I mean, I'm just testing some address. I'm pressing some keys, right, here in this editor, and I'm trying to figure out whether I see activity with flush and reload.
But how do you decide whether there is activity?
Well, actually, it's complicated. Some cache lines have a lot of activity without me doing anything. But other addresses, most of these, don't have any activity at all.
Yeah, let's go through this step by step and see whether we can find out how we can automate this. Which file to probe, which offsets. I mean, the virtual addresses doesn't matter, right?
Yeah, that's right. It's a shared library. It will be shared in the L3 cache based on the physical address. The virtual address also doesn't matter. Maybe we can start a list here. So which points do we have? So we have...
Number one, file and offset.
File and offset, okay.
Number two, we need to trigger a keystroke.
Yes.
Number three, we measure the hits and misses.
Yeah.
With flush and reload, and just finally we look at do we have a leak or not?
Yes. That sounds very good. Okay, so how do we go about these?
Just pressing the button there is a little bit of tedious work. Can we maybe automate the simulate key presses?
Yeah, I checked that. And actually there are devices, like USB devices, that fake a keyboard input via USB and you can program them. But I don't have them. I could order one, I guess.
Yeah, but that's expensive. I mean, we can simulate them using software, right? That should be possible.
I'm not sure.
Okay, just let me have a look. So I found this software here, it's called xdoodle, that allows you to simulate key presses.
Yeah, okay, so, sounds good. So I also had an idea for the files and addresses. So let's add a check mark. Let's say I want to attack some event, yeah? That could be a keystroke, that could be anything, playing out music, starting an encryption, anything. You need to find software that handles this event. And in my case, that's an editor, for instance, because I want to spy on the keystrokes. Yeah? And editors need to handle the keystrokes. For that software, you can scan the entire binary from file offset 0, yeah, as I also did here manually, to the end of the file. This would be probably too slow by hand.
Yeah, but also annoying.
Yeah, but automated, you wouldn't have the clicks. So this would be fast enough if we automated.
So for the program binary?
So you have the program binary and all the shared libraries that it uses. right? And I can check, I can show you that as well. I tried that. So if I use cut proc PID of gedit maps, then I can see all the files that this one has mapped. Yeah. It's a bit small, but maybe you can read it. And I can also grep in there for specific libraries. So we could scan through all of these files. We have all the start and ends of the mappings. So it should be possible. So that's sort of how I started with this. I stared at object dumps for such a long time for like disassemblies. And
Yeah. I think automation is a really good step to take.
Yeah.
It makes things easier, and sometimes you realize something like cache template attacks might be more powerful than thought at the beginning, right?
Oh, yeah, let's write that down. Thinking about the list here, step 3 is also already solved. That's just my flush and reload code.
Right.
Yeah, and that leaves us with one more thing. How to decide whether something leaks or not. And then they remember. Think of the corner cases. What are the two corner cases here? The corner cases. Maybe we can run this once with an event and once without an event.
Like once with a key structure and once without one.
Exactly, yeah. So let me start that. So I will run this UK library to 200 and then this path here. And if we run this, then you should be able to... Wait, this is... Look at this trace here.
What are these lines?
That's the address or the offset in the shared library. And here you see the number of cache hits.
So you see the number of cache hits for an address when you hit the key?
Yeah, exactly. So let me stop this. So this is some sort of, I would say, a profile for an event. And the event is I press the key.
So what happens if you put in this address in like a flush and reload spy tool?
Let me do that. Look at this. So if I type something here, any keystroke, and I can see it. It's a full keylogger.
Nice.
A keylogger?
Yeah. Any key that I press, I get a cache hit.
There's not a keylogger. A keylogger would detect exactly which key you pressed.
But I get the timings between each key, and from the timings, I could recover which key it was.
Yeah, well, because that worked so good for the first bin bat you tried to attack with that.
I can read this maybe on a password field, and then I can figure out how many letters your password has.
In which flat model? You have code running on my system?
No. If you sudo on a remote server.
Oh.
And I'm co-located on that server because I also have an unprivileged user account.
That's concerning.
Yeah. I suspect it works. It might depend on how the shared library is used, but this seems to work on all the shared libraries. libc, libgtk, libgdk. There are hundreds of megabytes of shared libraries mapped into completely normal binaries. But yeah, this is just an editor.
The events you distinguish are key press and no key press, right?
Yes. So that would also work on the password field then. But I need a few hours maybe to scan for the password entry field. Yeah.
So but you could do more, right? You could have one event per letter in the alphabet or per key on the keyboard. Something
Ooh.
Like that.
And then I would get a lot of profile vectors.
Yeah.
Yeah, give me a minute. I will implement this.
Do you really think there is code that accesses different cache lines based on the keystroke?
Yeah, we saw something there already.
Yeah, in the libgdk, which is part of the GTK framework that is used widely. So I have a script here which does that now. And so I just need to switch to the... No, wait.
And this is what template attacks, what side channel attacks are about if you do this profiling, right? So the important difference is compared to the other attacks, Instead of just purely using a heuristic, here we have two phases. In a first step, we go there and say, we profile how does the behavior look like, and we profile either using a simple threshold, a statistical model, or we learn a neural network. This is the first phase. And then in the exploitation phase, we essentially do the matching, right? So we say we have a device, there is an unknown secret in there, and based on what we have learned in the profiling, we simply want to find out what is in there. And what we typically get is maybe a straight answer, right? In the easy case of a threshold, we will get the answer, oh, it's got to be secret A or it got to be secret B. In a more complex setting, we might get something like a probability, right? Because if we learn the statistical model, what we will get is, you know, there are 256 possible things that are in there. You will get a probability for each one. And then you might need another observation, which might help to refine.
So if I compare this to a cache attack and I want to attack processor A, do I need to profile on the same process in order for the template to work?
So in the setting of the cache attacks, you have a quite simple model. You have a very similar model between different computers. You might have the same replacement algorithm or basically the same behavior in the cache that you observe, maybe even independent of the vendor. If you look at a very high level thing, right? So mm-hmm. if you throw out a cache line on one machine or another machine, and you then expect some other value to go into exactly this cache line, this will happen also on a different machine in the same manner as you did it on the profiled machine.
Okay. Wait a second, where is it? Here. I got it now. So this is this matrix that I got here.
So there are actual cache lines that differ based on which key you pressed?
Yeah. For instance, this one only reacts to the key N. I think this gets reasonably close to a real keylogger where we can distinguish single letters.
Can you actually try this out?
Yeah, just give me a second. So I run this. Okay, looks good. Yeah, look at this. So it seems to be a bit more noisy than before, but whenever I press a key, I see a cache hit.
Can you also try it with multiple cache lines?
Let me try that out. Okay, I will start just the second one. Whoa, take a look at this. This is getting spurious cache hits all the time. It doesn't work.
No. That must be the prefetcher. Wait, I have here something. Are you on an Intel processor?
On this laptop?
Yeah. Ah, wait. In the Intel manual, it states that there's this prefetcher that is very aggressive and it fetches cache lines from the RAM into the cache.
Based on what?
There are different prefetcher types. So basically, there's the streaming prefetcher, adjacent line prefetcher. They just predict what you will use in the future.
Okay. But wait a second. On this other address, so I see a lot of noise on this one, but I also tried one other address, and there everything is running fine.
Hmm. Ah, but it also states that the prefetch does not cross 4K boundaries, so it doesn't prefetch across pages.
Oh, so that means, because these addresses are a page apart, that they are not affected. So that explains why it stops working. Yeah.
So the template attack doesn't really work that well then?
Combinations might be tricky, but in general, I would say it works.
Hmm. So you could attack anything.
Yeah.
Isn't Doom something they use a lot for demonstrations?
Doom?
Yeah.
Yeah, sure, I can run a template on that. What do you want to scan for?
Keystrokes?
Okay, yeah. Just give me a second. Here it is. Here's the template.
The template of Doom.
Let's rewrite this.
So, could you automate the AES attack on Claudio's server?
Nope, patch that.
But a similar implementation? Sure, let me run that. Here it's running. I'm looking only at the cache lines where I get cache hits, and these are accessed all the time when I run AES. There are a few that are, oh, and these here, 92%.
That's a typical hit ratio for IIST tables.
Yeah, so this is the end of the t-tables. If we scroll up, there will be, yeah, that's all the t-tables. Yeah, sounds good.
Can you run it again with different key bytes?
Okay. Here I ran this now for this range with different plaintext bytes and a fixed key. What would you say?
That's exactly the pattern you get if key byte 0 is 0. And that's trivial to identify all cache lines.
And my key was all zeros. Yeah, so this really works. I think this is a new attack. I think I will call this cache template attacks.
Automating attacks on inclusive last level caches from 2015.
What? Who wrote that?
Maybe point out that there's a lot more you can attack with that.
I mean, that's actually what we do in our sidechain security master's course here at Graz University of Technology. We teach them how these attacks work and ask them to attack something that hasn't been attacked before.
Yeah, and we have seen very creative target applications. Let me check. Editors, password entries, command lines, media players, like VLC, leaking whether VLC is playing video or not. Browsers, mail programs, and leaking that for mail programs, for instance, leaking privacy-related information. Yeah.
But we could also turn this around, right? We could use the cache template attacks as a defender, right?
Oh, yeah. We also described that in the paper. So you can just take that in part as a part of your development process, and then you know whether it's sidechannel resistant.
Not just flush and reload, you can also use prime and probe. Simply automate the process, see which addresses leak.
That's correct. But for prime and probe, you only have a bunch of cache sets, right? For flush and reload, you have a much, much better spatial resolution because you have all the offsets in all the different shared libraries, shared files, and you can get very, very precise information on that with flush and reload.
I think that's enough for one episode. We should call it a day.
Yeah, sounds good.